Hi, I'm going to bounce off last week's God talk where I opened myself up to some heavy-handed criticism when I revealed that I did not believe that I had to be saved for my sins. So today I add to the controversy. Welcome to Calm in the Chaos, where real life is messy and we can disagree while we continue to love one another as co-inhabitants of our home. Brace yourself. Especially if you're new to the idea that Jesus didn't actually tell us we should worship him. He didn't present us with a list of behaviors for people who profess to be his people. He didn't instruct us to invite people to church. Humans who were building communities of people to support a common goal in their lives did that. He didn't instruct us to worship him with songs about how glorious his name is. Or to wear a shirt that says Jesus saves. He didn't expect people to have a children's program that used sports to entice kids to participate. That's a lure to teach more children stories of the Bible so they'll want to stay in that community longer and participate in potluck suppers and offering plate donations. It's a self-perpetuating business. Now, there's nothing wrong with potluck suppers, believe me, I've been to many. Many denominations are famous for cookbook fundraisers so that we can all enjoy recreating the savory casseroles and gooey desserts in our own kitchens. But to be Jesus-like, the potluck suppers should be open to anyone who's hungry. I've lived in two communities where churches provide a monthly free lunch on any given Sunday, and to top it off, the members of the church dine right alongside anyone who comes in off the street. That is the heart of Jesus. After listing a few ways that churches have missed the mark of being like Jesus, I offer some comments from clergy friends of mine. They are dismayed as well, but cannot break free from the system that we've built in our religious communities. I was visiting a church to check out what all the hype was about. When a recent news article touted the virtues of a growing church, increasing rapidly because of their inclusive banners hanging off the front door. Realizing I was a visitor, the pastor pulled me aside for a quick hello and a chat, and I thanked him for noticing that I was a visitor and said that I wasn't sure this was the church for me because I don't believe in the resurrection. He leaned in closer and said, "Neither do I." One summer evening, I attended a special program of a nearby church, and during the coffee and donuts time afterwards, the pastor and I struck up a conversation, and I mentioned how most of the programs I lead can be done anywhere, in the woods, in a backyard, in a living room. And I said, "I'm curious about the balance between the business of continuing a church building and the programs that are about spiritual lives." And she said, "I hate that we have to spend money on keeping up a building." Now, some of us know that we've strayed from the lessons of Jesus, but we're having trouble finding our way back. We've lost our compasses in the muck of modern life. Our GPS systems have long stopped since showing us the roads that get us to Jesus. Oh, to be honest, there are several current models of GPS that will lead us directly to a church building where we find yet another list of behaviors that will then take us straight to salvation or eternal heaven. But there are only a few that help us to follow the instructions laid out by Jesus. When we find a local guide for that journey, it's usually a quiet, no headlines sort of person because they're busy doing the work. They're humble and they don't need headlines and they live rich lives in the service of others. Doing the work of Jesus is well worded in the poem by Howard Thurman called The Work of Christmas. It's all the same. Here, I'll read it to you. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, When the shepherds are back with their flocks, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the people, and to make music in the heart. This poem is a retooling of the scripture from Matthew chapter 25. Here are those words. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Enter, you who are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation, and here's why. I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was homeless and you gave me a room. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me." Then the people are going to say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you? When did we ever see you thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you?" And the king will say, "I'm telling you the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it to me. Whatsoever you do to the least of these, you do to me." Let's unpack that a little bit. It's not a difficult concept. Jesus is saying that the divinity in every person we meet is him, a little spark of the cosmic Christ, a carrier of the energy of love. And when we treat one another in that light, in recognition of the truth of that divine spark, we are showing that we get it. We understand that to love and honor and truly act as though we're all parts of the same whole, we must visit the sick, give the homeless a shelter, feed hungry people and give clothing to people who need it, and visit people in prison. I generally take this to mean way more than the literal words indicate. To feed the hungry is first and foremost about filling bellies, because as Abraham Maslow taught us about the human hierarchy of needs, if a person's tummy is grumbling, they aren't going to care much for poetry or a big discussion on theology. But after we feed the people who are hungry with nutritious meals, we can look at the people who are hungry in a different way. How about those who are hungry for friendship, for community? How are we feeding them? Likewise, with visiting those in prison and those who are sick, we know that there are prison ministries designed to fulfill that instruction from Jesus to visit people who are incarcerated. Let's think a bigger thought. There are also people who are imprisoned by addiction to substances and to behaviors. How are we helping them? Visiting the sick isn't just in the literal drive to someone's residence and sit with them for a bit, although that's the biggest contribution we can make right now to stave off the national crisis of loneliness. Sit with somebody, be present. But visiting the sick can also be a virtual visit, letting someone just find a note in their mailbox. Okay, stamps cost more than the note cards and the envelopes now. But hey, most of us have the capability to pen one card to someone. Children and elderly people especially love getting snail mail. I hear how the cards are read over and over when they're placed within reach of an elderly person. Or get your holiday cards ready now for veterans who are deployed. Or visit a VA hospital. Two of my favorite ways to love the community are calling the local school district's cafeteria coordinator and paying off a couple of students' lunch debts, or paying some ahead. The second way is buying a tray of subs and delivering them to the local fire department, police department, or emergency room staff, when they're working on an evening that most of us are celebrating with loved ones, like Thanksgiving Day, Christmas Eve, New Year's Eve. You get the idea. So whether we attend a weekly service online or in a pew, or do neither one, we can act in the specific ways that Jesus taught, and many mystics and followers have practiced long after his time on earth. Let's join the ranks of people who behave like Jesus and not worry ourselves so much about which hymn goes with which Sunday of the liturgical year or how bad my sins have to be to keep me out of heaven. I'm going to get my note cards out right now. I feel a little thinking of you coming on. May your heart be filled with joy and your hands be busy with the year-round work of Christmas. Thank you for enjoying my pups who have made appearances today. We're filming in a remote location because I'm on vacation, and they are right here with me today. Let's pray together. Maha Kundalini Shakti, Mother, Father, God, Holy Spirit, Adonai, Great Spirit in the sky, Allah, we come to you this day in gratitude and in sorrow. We are grateful for the darkness that shows itself earlier in our evenings, for it gives us more time to appreciate the stars and the moon. We are grateful for the colors emerging in our vineyards and orchards and forests, for the reds, golds, and yellows that remind us change is inevitable. We are grateful for the falling leaves, for they remind us that everything has its season and new life will be born from the decaying leaves. Hear us now as we whisper our prayers of gratitude. Our hearts are heavy when we see the sunflowers and remember that they are the official flower of the Ukraine. Strengthen the people who continue to suffer at the hands of others through war, murders, and political motives. Our hearts are heavy when we remember the people on both sides of the borders where people are crossing with hope for a better life. Our hearts are heavy when we learn of devastation caused by hurricanes and other occurrences of nature. Hear us now as we whisper our prayers of concern. With all that is holy, we say, Amen. Today's music recommendation is a surprise. I hope it touches your heart. Blessings on all.